Maybe everyone. As you can see, this is this message is going to be out of 1 Samuel chapter 1. I'm going to read through verse 1 through 20. And I also want to just say that this message and reading through it and just being brought through it was definitely a blessing for me. I heard this story a couple times before, actually several times before, and really never saw the parallels that I saw this time. And God was merciful to teach me the gospel over again in this story of Hannah. So hopefully I can share it with you and it can be as precious to you as it is to me. So I'll get started off, give you a little you'd call it background, but not really. 1 Samuel, in 1 Samuel there was a man and he had two wives. One was named Hannah, and one was named, I think it's Peninnah. So, Peninnah could have children. I think after reading through a couple of different commentaries, they all agreed that she gave the man Elkanah about 10 kids, and Hannah could not. She was barren. So I'm going to read the first three verses for you and then kind of get into the message. So here we go. 1 Samuel chapter 1 and verse 1 through 3. Now there was a certain man of, no idea how to say that, of Mount Ephraim, and his name was Elkanah, the son of Jeroham, the son of Elihu, the son of Tohu, the son of Zuph, and Ephrathite. And he had two wives. The name of one, a name of the one was Hannah, and the name of the other, Peninnah. And Peninnah had children, but Hannah had no children. This man went up out of his city yearly to worship and to sacrifice unto the Lord of hosts in Shiloh. And the two sons of Eli, Hophni, and Phinehas, the priests of the Lord, were there. So this man, Elkanah, looked up his name, the meaning of his name, and, you know, like it was like a lot of the Old Testament men, his name had a meaning that pertained to whatever was happening to his parents at the time, that gave his birth meaning to them. So the meaning of his name was God created. So God made. So this shows that since this was Hannah's husband, it shows that the provision for Hannah was created by God alone. So from the very beginning, sets the stage for this gracious bringing of Hannah the things that she needed in this life. So another thing to kind of, I guess, point out is in this time there was no such thing as infertility treatments. There was no such thing as, you know, drugs you could take, things you could, examine to fix this problem she had. And Hannah was barren. And they all considered this to be a curse from God. And that was because she couldn't produce an heir for her husband. She couldn't have any kids. And the women of that time were mostly wives and mothers, so they weren't really career focused. So that was really her purpose in the family. So I just wanted to kind of point that out because Hannah, in this situation, is a lost person shown in type. Helpless, hopeless. She's plagued with a curse and unable to help herself to fulfill this need to remove that, problem that she had. So in Romans 3:12, it says, this is this is a description of the sinner. This is a description of man in his natural state. It says, they are all gone out of the way. They are together become unprofitable. There is none that doeth good, no, not one. So, just like Hannah here, no ability, nothing, no way to overcome this curse, this problem, this perceived curse. So the curse on the lost man isn't necessarily just infertility. It isn't this problem. But it's the sin of Adam that's passed down unto all men. And Romans 5, verse 12 to 14 explains this. It says, wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. For until the law, sin was in the world, but sin is not imputed where there is no law. Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over them that had not sinned after the similitude of Adam's transgression, who is the figure of him that was to come. So, just basically saying that Adam gave everyone from that point forward his sin, his transgression, and they were all sentenced to death. And also, after the law was presented, that's when sin appeared, personal sin, the sin that man can do himself. So the law has been presented. So it's there. And it reigned from Adam to Moses. Even before that, even though all the people before that didn't sin the same way Adam did at that time. So there's no escape. It's there. It's permanent. It infects everyone from that point forward. So then later on in 1 Samuel, verse 4 and 5, shows that Elkanah, her husband, loved and provided for Hannah all the days of her life. But throughout that, his other wife, Peninnah, provoked her, caused her to have a terrible life. So verse 4 and 5, it says, and when the time was that Elkanah offered, this is the peace offering that he brought to the temple, he gave to Peninnah his wife and all her sons and her daughters portions. But unto Hannah he gave a worthy portion, for he loved Hannah, but the Lord had shut up her womb. So even though Hannah was barren, even though she couldn't have any children, Elkanah still took care of her and favored her, even though she couldn't provide an heir for him. The Lord had shut up her womb. But was this really a curse? Or was it to show her that without him, this barren woman, and the meaning of barren, I looked it up, it says unproductive, infertile, and unfruitful. So this unfruitful sinner was nothing, could provide nothing. So even though God's people are this, God's lost people, it's lost sinners, are unproductive, unfruitful sinners, they're shown his grace through the righteousness of Christ. So farther on in Romans 5, verse 15 through 17, it says, but not as the offense, so also is the free gift. So the offense is present, but so is the free gift for his people. For if though the offense of one many be dead, much more the grace of God and the gift by grace, which is by one man, Jesus Christ, hath abounded unto many. So even though the sin of Adam imputed death unto all of his people, the grace of God through Jesus Christ gave them life. And not as it was by one that sinned, so is the gift. So Christ had no sin. For the judgment was by one to condemnation, but the free gift is of many offenses unto justification. So that free gift of grace imputed by God through the Lord Jesus Christ, justifies all his people. For if by one man's offense death reigned by one, much more they which receive abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one, Jesus Christ. So Christ gives them free grace and life through his work, through his blood, through his death. So I know that kind of sums it all up in one, but it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if she can't produce. It doesn't matter if she can't give that, she can't give herself that life. God's going to give it to her. God's going to give it to that that lost person. Still, as yet, Hannah was made bitter by the situation and by the constant problems and constant provoking of Peninnah. But she was comforted. Who was she comforted by? Well, let's read 6 through 12. And her adversary also provoked her sore, for to make her fret, because the Lord had shut up her womb. And as he did so year by year, when she went up to the house of the Lord, so she provoked her. Therefore she wept and did not eat. So this is, I'm fairly certain this is Peninnah, was her adversary. So then said Elkanah, her husband, to her, Hannah, why weepest thou? And why eatest thou not? And why is thy heart grieved? Am I not better to thee than 10 sons? I think this is where they got the Peninnah having 10 sons, or having 10 children, or something like that. So Hannah rose up after they had eaten in Shiloh, and after they had drunk. Now Eli the priest sat upon a seat by a post of the temple of the Lord, and she was in bitterness of soul, and prayed unto the Lord, and wept sore. And she vowed a vow, and said, O Lord of hosts, if thou wilt indeed look on the affliction of thine handmaid, and remember me, and not forget thine handmaid, but wilt give unto thine handmaid a man-child, then I will give him unto the Lord all the days of his life. And there shall no razor come upon his head. And it came to pass, as she continued praying before the Lord, that Eli marked her mouth. So, in verses 6 through 7, Hannah's adversary, Peninnah, reminded Hannah year after year of her infertility, of her problem, provoking her until she wept. Well, this shows, Peninnah shows the adversary of God's people, Satan himself, the devil. And he reminds us of all of our faults, consuming our minds, getting our eyes off of the solution, and putting our eyes on the problem that we can't solve. We have no ability to solve ourselves. And this adversary could be someone else. It could be ourselves, reminding ourselves of the past, reminding ourselves of things that are out of our control completely. But God's word calls us to be weary of this and not to fret. So in 1 Peter 5:8 says, be sober, be vigilant. So that's being vigilant is to be aware, to be alert. Because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about, seeking whom he may devour. That devouring is the devouring of your mind. The battle is in your head. The battle with Satan is very real. And he can take over. He's very much more powerful than any of us. But he's not more powerful than the Lord Jesus Christ. So Hannah, in verses 8 through 10, she's in distress. She didn't want to eat of that yearly sacrifice. She didn't want to go up to the temple. Until Elkanah, and remember that means God created, said, am I not better than 10 sons? And he lifted Hannah's spirit enough to bring her to the temple in prayer. Bring her to God, the one that could really change her position, to change her situation. So this shows, as has been preached here many times, it's God who causes his people to pray to him in times of need. It's God who brings them to him, even when they're bitter in spirit and beaten down by Satan, until they just want to lay down and cry, until they just want to give up, do nothing. So Matthew 6:8, it says, be not therefore like unto them. So be not therefore like unto the people who try to take control of their situation. For your Father knoweth what things ye have need of before ye ask him. So he knew what Hannah needed. He knew what Hannah was even going to ask for before she prayed. He had this all set out for her to bring her to him. Just like every lost person sets that path out. So when God gives a believing heart to that lost sinner, to that lost person, to any of his people, through his Spirit, whatever they ask for in prayer, according to God's word, he gives to them. So according to Christ's name. John 15:7 is Christ speaking to the disciples. If ye abide in me, and my words abide in you, ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you. So all these things, all these prayers, if you look through the prayers and Psalms, they can speak volumes to your heart. Can he speak volumes to your situation? If you're ever looking for a place to read in God's Word, Psalms is an awesome, awesome place. It'll bring God's Word that's already been revealed to you to remembrance in your mind. And it'll remind you of those comforts that he's already given you. And then he'll give you even more from that revelation. It's awesome. So getting back to this, Hannah then pleads to God in her distress. Just stays before him, lays before him year after year. Verse 13 through 17 says, "Now Hannah, she spake in her heart, only her lips moved, but her voice was not heard. Therefore Eli thought she had been drunken. And Eli said unto her, How long wilt thou be drunken? Put away thy wine from thee. And Hannah answered and said, No, my Lord, I am a woman of a sorrowful spirit. I have drunk neither wine nor strong drink, but have poured out my soul before the Lord. Count not thine handmaid for a daughter of Belial, or the devil. For out of the abundance of my complaint and grief have I spoken hitherto. Then Eli answered and said, Go in peace, and the God of Israel grant thee thy petition that thou hast asked of him." So I looked up this word sorrowful in Strong's Concordance. And the word is quash-a, and it's meaning hard or severe. So if you look in verse 15, it says, "And Hannah answered and said, No, my Lord, I am a woman of a sorrowful spirit, or a hard spirit." What does that sound like? That brought me to Hannah seeing that her problem is one of a hard heart. She had a heart of stone. She needed exchanged. The exchange for a different one. And she follows this up with saying that she didn't want it to identify her and asks not to be counted as a daughter of Belial or the devil. She didn't want to be counted with the transgressors, the other ones with that hard heart. She wanted to be identified with something else. So when God's people are caused by him to see that their problem is their hard heart and their inability to change it, they cry to God to be relieved of it. They go before him, they bow before him, they stay before him, and they ask him in prayer, a prayer that he causes them to say. And they don't want to be counted with the transgressors, and they know that only God can give that new heart. Ezekiel 36:26, it says, God saying this to the children of Israel, God saying this through Ezekiel, "A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you. And I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh," that hard heart of iniquity, of turning away from God, "out of your flesh, and I will give you an heart of flesh." Give you a new spirit that calls out to God, new spirit that relies on him for provision. Just like Elkanah, just God made provision. So then Hannah's prayer shows every person who's given trials by and caused to pray to this God and wait diligently before him, they're also given to know that those prayers are heard by him. They're given that response. They're comforted by it. Psalm 41 says, "To the chief musician, a Psalm of David," this is the last part, "I waited patiently for the Lord," waited patiently in prayer before the Lord, "and he inclined unto me and heard my cry." That waiting patiently means you don't take your own initiative. You don't take your own, you don't go by your own sparks, as Pastor said before. You wait. You wait for guidance. You wait for direction. You wait for God to reach out to you and say, I got this handled. Don't worry about it. It'll all work out for you. So Hannah sees in this, after all this happens and she's just marred down with distress and she's just being reminded of this problem over and over again by the people around her, she sees that she's found God's grace. In verse 18 through 20, it says, and she, Hannah, said, let thine handmaid find grace in thy sight. So the woman went her way and did eat, and her countenance was no more sad. So she, that all that distress, all that bitterness was lifted from her. And they rose up early in the morning and worshiped before the God, before the Lord, and returned and came to their house in Ramah. And Elkanah knew Hannah his wife, and the Lord remembered her. Wherefore it came to pass, when the time was come, about after Hannah had conceived, that she bare a son, and called his name Samuel, saying, because I have asked him of the Lord. So through this, through going and staying before the Lord, and him causing her to realize that she's provided for, that she's going to be comforted in him, she's given relief, knowing that God was with her the whole time. Faith to know that he will provide this new life for her, the new life that she was asking for. Hannah and Elkanah have that God-given faith. We're given that God-given faith, and it caused them to worship God and know that she would be given new life in the gift that she had prayed for year after year, this son named Samuel. And that meaning of that name is asked of God. And it says that pretty much in the verse, but she asked him for it. She asked him for it not because she knew it's what she needed. It's because God knew it's what she needed. God knew it's what she yearned for. So this faith, this shows this faith in lost man, this faith given to lost man, it's one of the fruits of the Spirit. It's one of the fruits of the Spirit that it's imputed to God's people by the death of Christ. Christ, it couldn't come. The Comforter couldn't come unless Christ died for his people. And Galatians 5:22 just calls this out as one of the fruits of the Spirit. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith. Whose faith is this? Is it ours? If it was, it'd be as worthless as anything else man can produce. Just like we were saying before, when I read in Romans 3:12, unprofitable, none that doeth good, no, not one. So can't be our faith. If it was, it would be worthless. It'd be no good. It's Christ's faith. Christ's faith imputed to his people, and his Spirit causes his people to know that their prayer for new life, prayer for a new heart, is answered, relieving them of their distress of being that unfruitful, barren sinner, the one that can't do anything to relieve that iniquitous state, to relieve that curse that's put upon them. God gave his people grace through the sacrifice of his son on the cross, and through his blood and righteousness, they're given new life in him. Just like Hannah was given new life in her son. John 3:16-17, the most misquoted verse ever, says, for God so loved the world, for every believer in the world, that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. That belief is a gift of grace. For God sent not his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. So It's only through Christ that that new life can be given, that new spirit, that new heart. And the only way that happens is for him to die and shed his blood for his elect. So, kind of conclude and wrap all this up. God's people are shown by his grace that they're unfruitful, lost sinners. Even before we're brought to know the Lord saving, after we're brought to know the Lord savingly. If he didn't remind us, then we'd walk. If he didn't show us, if he didn't keep us, we'd rely on ourselves. We'd look away. And that we can do no good, and it causes us to be distressed. It causes us to look for another way, to look to him, to know there's something missing in our lives. There's no life. There's no life in us. Those lost sinners are then caused to call on God through prayer, provide new life for them, and remove that hard heart we once possessed. And then he gives us that new heart, that new spirit, by the sacrifice of his son. So this story of Hannah and her prayer shows this pretty well, I think. That with consistent pleading, staying before the Lord, staying before God, she was shown mercy and given that new life she knew she needed.